If you look around the world, agriculture is the biggest employer. And the majority of those farmers are small-scale farmers in water-stressed countries where people also often do not have grid electricity access. The most powerful means of helping them rise out of poverty is irrigation, because they can grow more and higher value crops and make more money. Challenge is that already 70% of fresh water in the world is used for irrigation. So we have to think, how can we enable these farmers to benefit from irrigation, but do it in a way that is compatible in terms of water use and in terms of economic constraints for where they live?
Water share per capita has declined. Most of our groundwater resources have been depleted. Jordan faces this great challenge of being able to produce food with less amounts of water. We live at a time where agriculture needs to be precise.
There are countries in this region who are 50 to up to 90% dependent on imports. And food security is really linked with national security here. What we are looking at is this nexus between water, energy, and food. And that's where this MIT solution comes into play.
We wanted to provide the benefits of precision agriculture in historically non-precise environments. And the way we did that was realizing that we could put a lot of the computation power for an irrigation system, deciding how to use energy and how much water to move day by day, we could put those capabilities up in the cloud. And then we could just send commands down to the field, and in many cases, received by a farmer's smartphone.
Tomorrow when the schedule is going.
To say when to turn on different parts of the system in order to maximize your usage of energy and minimize your wastage of water.
Good. Thank you. Bye. We've talked to over 100 farmers, and we found that they're really interested in solar power. So what we're trying to do is optimize various components of the system to make sure that that cost is as low as possible.
We're running this field pilot in Kenya, Morocco, and Jordan, because these are all great candidate markets for eventual adoption of our technology, but for different reasons. In Kenya, we've seen that there's a large opportunity for growth of smart irrigation, particularly in smaller scale to medium scale farms. Precise irrigation or smart irrigation really hasn't been adopted. In the Middle East and North Africa, you have a lot of water stress. We're testing in Jordan a system that's still manually operated by the farmhand, where they're getting smartphone commands and running a drip irrigation system with solar power. And then in Morocco, we're running that technology, but with automation, because we're running on a bigger farm that has the capability where the system can automatically turn on and off different parts of the field.
The objective of this project is to reduce the upfront and ongoing cost of drip irrigation, particularly off-grid drip irrigation.
People usually understand their own problems really well, and they're very good at coming up with solutions to them.
These farmers are very smart, they're very intuitive, they're very resourceful.
And so as designers, our role really is to provide a different set of expertise and another avenue for them to get the tools or the resources that they need.
Drip irrigation works by using a network of pipes throughout the farm and delivering water directly to the root of the crops, and that helps save water.
Typically, drip irrigation is promoted as a water-saving technology, but this is really only the case if farmers are operating the drip system correctly. And this is the purpose of introducing a controller that can help the end user properly irrigate without risking the livelihood of the farmer, but ensure that they're still gaining the benefits of drip irrigation.
The controller takes in weather information, relative humidity, temperature, irradiance, wind speed values, as well as precipitation. And using AI, it calculates and predicts what the solar irradiance profile is over the day, as well as what is the exact irrigation needs for the farmer. It can also use extra energy and store it in a battery for later times of low solar radiance. Different countries will have different soil types, different crop types. They'll have a different layout on their farm, and all of this can be incorporated into the controller to make it flexible and specific to that farm.
It's crazy to me to think about what a normal PhD experiment looks like. We're all the way across the world, we're on a real farm, and this is a big, like, hectare scale farm setup. So to see all this come together, to see the technology, see the solar panels, weather station, the controller in the pump house, and this size of farm that we can irrigate is amazing. The way this technology works is that we're always tuning the water delivered to the plants given it their needs. I think a unique facet of how we've approached this research is that we've concurrently advanced the technology of these smart irrigation systems while also learning about end users' needs and their requirements and the value propositions that would drive them to adopt the technology.
Our group is very good at creating design theories and optimization theories to be able to understand complex trade-offs. But the thing that really gets us there is doing frequent field work with stakeholders. It's not just that it has to be good for the farmers, it has to be good for the people that are going to make it run every day, and it has to be good for the people that are going to sell it, and it has to be good for the people who are going to make policy around it. So we have to align all of those interests.
The MIT Gear Lab has logically thought through the steps and been engaged with farmers to see what they need and how they would apply this technology.
What was most impressive today is how eager farmers wanted to have access to these technologies. So the questions about when will this be ready for us to purchase? What is the cost of this technology versus that?
I'm a farmer. I want to change my mortality to a new one. So I come here to learn. I think it will help me in my farm.
Everybody's so friendly and so helping and really just wants to see this become a real product and help people in their countries. So I'm just so grateful for all the people that I've worked with. I think that's the thing that I'll remember most.
So I think we have all the building blocks that we need to cover this last mile. We are almost there. We have a private sector partner, we have the institutional partner, and we have the research and R&D partners with us. So I think together we complete the bigger picture.
It's an incredible opportunity for a scalable outcome to research.
We're always trying to design systems that will integrate into ecosystems. We have a lot of control about how we design the system, but the ecosystem is there and we have minimal influence over it. So we have to adapt to it while we innovate for it. Because it's so easy to innovate something that's novel but worthless. If we want to make a real world impact, the only way to do that is boots on the ground. Because there's no way me in a lab in Cambridge, Massachusetts understands what life is like for a farmer in Kenya.